the topic that we selected for this talk is Gujarati literature beyond, before, with, and beyond Gandhi. So it is Gujarati literature, but we are putting it in a frame. And I would like to say something about that in the course of our talk today. I'm glad and grateful to be here at Hyderabad Literary Festival that has China as its guest nation and has a focus on Gujarati literature. This year, 2019, marks, as Amitabhen said, 150th birth anniversary of Mahatma Gandhi. Gujarati was not only Gandhiji's mother tongue, he chose Gujarati language to write all his seminal books, including Hind Swaraj, the radical book, the famous autobiography, Satyana Prayogo or My Experiments with Truth, and the fascinating history of Satyagraha in South Africa. He wrote all these books in Gujarati. Then they were translated by either himself or somebody else. You must keep this in mind, this move of a great writer who had perfect command over English and not bad over Hindi either. So, from the beginning of the 19th century, British colonial power was consolidated in Gujarat, as in Bengal. After 1857, colonial culture consolidated its grip over cultural life in India, and especially of Gujarat. One of the consequences of this was marginalization of Indian languages and prioritization of English. Gujarati elite in general began to accept English as the preferred language of discourse and started to doubt the capacity and vitality of their own language, Gujarati. Gandhi's response to this situation was very strong but also demanding. He said, "Our language is the reflection of ourselves. And if you tell me that our languages are too poor to express the best, our best thoughts, then I say that the sooner we are wiped off out of existence, the better for us." Gandhiji would not usually say this. When I first read this, I was reminded of the last days of Adolf Hitler. It's so strong. But being Gandhi, he added something which distinguished him, even in his passion for his mother tongue, from the passion, dominating passion, of dictators for their own cultures. Because Gandhi added, "As to my mother's breast," he said, "I must cling to my mother tongue." Here's the verb he uses. "I must cling to my mother tongue as to my mother's breast, because it alone can give me life-giving milk." So from this, This is an interesting discourse by Gandhi, who first says that we must be wiped off the face of the earth, and then turns to the mother image. And mother tongue becomes much more meaningful a term, not just the tongue that mother taught us, but a language which nourishes us like our mother. Because nourishment could come from various sources, and Gandhi took nourishment from all the sources. But that does not mean that you do away with the milk of your mother. It is appropriate that Hyderabad Literary Festival has decided to focus on Gujarati literature in this year of Gandhi's 150th birth anniversary. Gandhi's good friend and great poet Rabindranath Tagore, who founded Vishwa Bharati University at Shantiniketan in 1921, using all the funds that came his way with the Nobel Prize in 1913, started within 2 decades. Started in April 1937, an Institute of Chinese Language and Culture, and he called it China Bhavan. So he uses the word Bhavan and doesn't use the word China. He says China Bhavan. This is also an interesting move on part of the Bengali writer, great Bengali writer. It is thus most appropriate that 2019 edition Hyderabad Literary Festival has China as its guest of nation guest. We all warmly congratulate the organizers, their thoughtful and capable directors, Amitaben, Ajay Bhai, Vijay Bhai, and their colleagues for this. Some recent research has begun to explore historical relationship between China and Gujarat. Gujarati traders, Hindu, Muslim, Parsi, have been trading with China for centuries, establishing rich cultural links between the two. Recent research on a 12th century Chinese book, it's called, if I, again, 40 or 50% pronunciation, Zhu Fan Ji, by the writer Zhao Rugua, was born in 1170 and died in 1231. That is a 12th century writer. 13th century writer. His book is translated as Treatise on Foreign Countries, and it has a full chapter on trade with Gujarat. The year 1170, the year this author, Zhao Rugua, was born, 1170, has a great significance for Gujarati literature, because it marks the composition of the first literary work, Bharateshwar Bahubali Ghor, in Gujarati language, deviating from the long convention that literary texts should be composed only in one of the three pan-Indian languages, namely Sanskrit, Prakrit, and Apavansha. Something that some people think that before 13th century or in Karnataka before 9th century, things were written only in Sanskrit, which is not true. It was written either in Sanskrit or in Prakrit or in Apapranishas. Gujarati literature composed in Gurjar Apapranisha goes back to the 6th century. In the 12th century, a great Jain monk, Acharya Hemachandra, composed a grammar of this Apapranisha language, titled Siddha Haim Apavansha Vyakarana. It combines Rajasthan and Gujarat. And it also combines in the title his own name with the name of the Chaulukya king, Siddharaj Jaisi, who was his patron. Siddharaj Jaisi was a staunch Shaiva, and Hemchandra was a staunch Jain. But they were staunch Gujaratis. And that's what made the difference. And that is what could make difference today. That's where we are talking of the evolution of Gujarati literature in context of Gandhi, because this evolution could be, as we'll see, be traced through various contexts, but we'll see about that. This book on Gurjar Apapranisha quotes a large number of Gujarati Apapranisha poems in Doha meter, a meter that later became most popular with poets writing in the newly emerging local languages in central and western India. Not in Maharashtra though. Some of the Doha couplets emerging would give us a flavor of Gujarati poetry on the turn of the first millennium of the Common Era. Predominant sentiments in the poems of that period were love and valor. One such poem describes the love of a lady who is of glowing color of champaka flower, golden yellow, and her lover, whose body is strong like a rock and dark complexion. Now this Jain and Hindu is one combination. And here is the very fair lady and a dark man. These are the things which India teaches us through literature, if you really know how to listen to Indian literature. So describing their love, the poet says, I'll say it in Apabhrinsha, Dholla Samala Dhana Champa Vanni Nai Son Reh Kasavat Idinni. To translate, husband is dark complexion and wife has a color of champaka flower. It looks as they embrace each other, as if a goldsmith is testing purity of a piece of gold on a dark tough stone and has made a flowing golden line on the strong dark surface of the stone. There is so much beauty, but there is also so much meaning in it. So these are the early beginnings of Gujarati poetry, Gujarati literature. Another poem tells of the valor in times of defeat. Wife has received news that her husband, a soldier in the region's army, has been killed on the battlefield. She would probably not last much longer now, either through love or through custom of the day. But before the Johar, perhaps, she tells her Sakhi, her female companion, "Oh friend, it was good that my husband was killed on the battlefield fighting. Had he run away from the battle and rushed home, I would have become shamefaced among my people." You can get the flavor of the people of India at that time, their defeat and their valor. They were not very victorious around that period. Defeat after defeat faced us. How we accept that defeat, how we overcame that defeat without military might. And that is where Gandhi enters. Had this not been done, had all these things not been done, Gandhi would not have been born in the 19th century. So that is how Gujarati literature before Gandhi. And that's why Gandhi is not doing a favor to Gujarati literature. Gujarati literature is doing a favor to Gandhi. That is the narrative. And so again, with all the Indian languages and all the 19th century leaders of India, they were all nourished by long traditions of literature in their own languages, own mother tongues, like mother would nourish a child. With love and valor, the third main experience in pre-modern Gujarati literature was that of bhakti, or longing for God. Bhakti combined with love and valor had a specific flavor. One of the most significant errors in the historiography of Gujarati literature comes perhaps from this chemistry of bhakti movement. Every literature has its originary moment, historical or otherwise. In popular historiography of Gujarati literature, its Adikavi or originary poet was not from the 12th century. Though lots of Gujarati literature was written, poems or so, good poems were written in 12th, 13th, 14th century. But Gujarat remembers another poet from 15th century as its Adikavi. You must look at it closely, analyze it, try to understand what is going on in this error of historiography. So, though much was written in narrative poetry of Gujarati during those 200 years, Gujarat insists on considering popularly as its Adi Kavi a 15th century bhakti poet, Narsingh Mehta. Why Narsingh Mehta? While this evidently is an error in historiography, but it also has deep significance for cultural history of Gujarat. Why Narsingh as Adi Kavi of Gujarat? To give a concise account of how Gujarati literature fared over 10 centuries from its origins in Gurjar Rabindranath Sahitya at the turn of the first millennium, from 600 to 1200 of Common Era, found its identity during the first half of the second millennium, first half of the second millennium, and reached pinnacle of its medieval poetry in 15th or mid-19th century, and grew in our own times in various Gandhian and post-Gandhian modes. We must try to understand why Narsi was seen as the Adikavi. There are so many stories that Narsi tells about himself. And one of these stories is how he went for a morning dip in Junagadh into a little pond called Damodar Kund. Early in the morning goes a Brahmin, pious man, of the highest caste, even among the Brahmins, highest, much honored. And there he says, and all my Gujarati friends would know it by heart, Giri Tralit in Kund Damodar, Tya Meta Ji Na Vajai. Ded Varanama Drad Hari Bhakti, Te Prem Dharine Lagya Pai. So the untouchables came and they bowed down to him. He was a bhakta, but he was also an agar. So they say that please come and do kirtan in our place. For a while Narsi hesitated, and I have a play on it too. So for a while Narsi hesitated, but then he says, Paksha Pakshitya Nahi Parameshwar. Where you differentiate amongst human beings, God is not there, God is absent. Samadrashti ne sarva saman. So samadrashti hai, usko to sarva saman hai. And he says, Gaumutra tulasi vriksha libjo. Okay, you take some gaumutra, you do some tulasi vriksha, and I'll come. And in an immortal line, he says, Bhor thaya alag bhajan kidu. Bhor means early dawn. He says, then we all got together until early dawn we sang of God. In which sky this early dawn dawned? Not in the physical sky, but in the skies of Gujarati literature. That is why, that is the originary moment of Gujarati poetry. Because it is exactly at that state that Gujarati poetry deviated from Gurjar Rabindranath poetry. Gurjar Rabindranath poetry had valor and love and everything, but it didn't have this sense of equality, this sense of humbleness, this courage, which is courage very different from the courage that you need on battlefront. This is a courage that you need to fight your own and not fight the other. This is what Gandhiji was for India. He taught us, of course, how to fight the British. But even more so, he taught us how to fight with ourselves. We have forgotten how to fight with ourselves. And that is exactly why we are forgetting how to fight with high capitalism coming either from our guest nation or from any other place. Gujarati literature, in its originary moment, teaches us that both the battles had to be fought simultaneously. It is two fronts, not one front. On both the fronts you have to fight, inner and outer. Only when you win the inner battle, then the whole world will feel scared of you before they step on you. So this is Narsi. This is why Narsi Mehta was... It is not too often that some seminal person arises in the history of a culture, like Buddha or Jesus, who radically changes our present time, modifies the way we look at the entire past of our culture, and how we aspire for a future as it perhaps never was imagined in that culture. So Gandhi did three things at the same time. He changed our present. He changed Gujarati literature of the time. He changed the very language of Gujarati literature. He said, write in a language which could be understood even by a farm hand. Kesh koshio samjhe vibhasha malako. Of course, he insisted too much on Kosho, so other registers of language were somewhat neglected, and that is where Beyond Gandhi comes in. So, but let's not go beyond Gandhi too quickly. But so he changed our present. But at the same time, much more significantly, he changed our past. Past is too vast for any culture or any person to experience simultaneously. It is too complex. It has too many contradictions in it. It's too vast for us to comprehend it as a person or as a people at the same time. One always selects. How do you select? There is a problem. There are some people who select their past through some ideology. And they create so much mess. They have created so much mess, both the ideologues of the left and the ideologues of the right. The ideologues of the left created the mess, and the ideologues of the right are compounding the mess. So, Gandhi taught us something else we have forgotten. How to remember our past? How to create, how to historicize our past? And that's where Dakshin Africana Satyagrahano Itihas comes in. The history of Satyagraha in South Africa. When he was in South Africa, Gandhi brought out, as you know, sir, Indian opinion. Now, the man who loved his mother tongue so much, loved so many other languages, other people's mother tongues equally well. If you love your mother, how can you dislike mother of your neighbor? That's why in our languages, we have such beautiful word, mausi, mashi. In our languages, in Western languages, it's just aunt, auntie, auntie or whatever. But here we have mashi, who is our mother's sister, and kaki, who is our chachi, who is our father's sister. And you are always somewhat scared of your chachi or kaki, and you always love your mashi. So, that is how Gandhi taught us to relate to mother tongues of other Indians. And today, each language is contesting. That's why I am also bringing in Ababrindishi now. Because other languages, we are classical languages. We are 2,000 years old. They can even claim that we are 5,000 years old. So we are artificially creating our past, our linguistic past, how violently. Great violence to each other. We are the classical language, Gujarati, theek hai. Rajasthani, poor Rajasthani, which is the mother tongue for Hindi and Gujarati, it has been wiped off from Rajasthan, almost. Look at the violence and look at Gandhi. Why do we remember Gandhi? Gandhi brought out Indian opinion, not only in Gujarati, because there were lots of Gujarati Muslims and Gujarati Hindus and Gujarati Parsis also in South Africa who fought along with him in his early Satyagraha, but also the Tamilians were there. So I had a very nice discussion with a Tamilian friend this morning. Each one was telling that how Gujarati was good or Gujarati was bad. So it was just you know, fun and so nothing wrong. But Gandhi was fighting for the Tamilians. So Indian opinion was brought out in Tamil also. Tamil. He also published it in Hindustani and in English. So this is the also, you know, and the medieval Gujarati writers were multilingual. Till almost yesterday, even today, lots of Gujarati writers write in Brajabhasha. There are many Gujarati writers who write in Marathi, and there are many Marathi writers who write in Gujarati or bilingual also. There is a young, there is a Tamilian short story writer who is also of Gujarati origin. This is natural to us by multilinguality. And that is also one aspect of Gujarati literature related with Gandhi that I would like to place before you. Now, why this multilinguality? Gandhi's pathway of non-violence, self-sacrificing but relentless struggle for freedom, identity and peace has reached mankind in its many habitats. Martin Luther King in America, Nelson Mandela in Africa, Khan Abdul Ghaffar Khan, known as Frontier Gandhi in Balochistan, Dalai Lama in Tibet, Yugoslav leader Ibrahim Rugova, known as Gandhi of the Balkans, and I have a poem on it, on Ibrahim Rugova. And the Beatles, musician John Lennon and Yoko Ono in England, represent millions over the world who attempt to resolve conflicts and shape self-identity through Gandhian way. Thus, after his assassination in India, Gandhi lives on globally, and so do his ways of thinking radically, feel compassionately, and act fearlessly. There is a Hindi writer, poet, Suresh Rituparna. He has a beautiful poem on Gandhi with which I would like to begin the next phase of our talk. Rituparna says that we really don't relate to Gandhi. We have killed him. Somebody has killed him and we cannot protect him. But we cannot forget him either. So, वो कहता है कि एक बंदरिया जैसे अपने मरे हुए बच्चे को अपनी छाती से अलग नहीं कर सकती है, just as a female monkey cannot put away its infant even after the infant has been killed. Similarly, we cannot put down Gandhi and his memories. It's lost in this poem of Rituparna. Because on the one hand, there is guilt. Because bandiriya ka bachche ko kisi aur ne maar dala hai, lekin humne mara isko. The child of the monkey has been killed by somebody else, not so with Gandhi. And we did nothing to protect him. When we were singing all songs on Lal Kila, he was nowhere in Delhi. Poor fellow was walking with bleeding feet in Noakhali, before his tired heart was shot at, his never tiring feet were traveling the pathway of peace and friendship and brotherhood in most dangerous paths. He wanted to go to Punjab. Now, this strength of Gandhi is something that you find in Gujarati literature and something that you miss in Gujarati literature. So what happened before Gandhi, I have told you briefly, namely the production of Narasimha Mehta, the production of multilingual writers of the medieval period, the combination of love and valor and bhakti into satyagraha, which is valor, of course, which is compassion, of course, which is love also, and this relentless satyagraha. So he came to Gujarat from South Africa in 1915. And 1945, we got the independence, and in a year, we did away with him. So during that period, what did Gujarat do? How did Gujarati literature shape up? Gujarat did not follow Gandhi's prescriptions as if it was a patient and Gandhi was a doctor. That would have been the end of Gujarati literature. We have seen this happen in so many places where ideologies are dictatorial. They dictate to the writers. And this is a fight we are right now conducting in Gujarat against our Sahitya Academy, which, because of a great Gandhian poet, Umashankar Joshi, was given a new constitution and new constituency which elected its president. A few years back, that was scrapped and government appointed a president on that. And since then, we have been opposing that and we have been boycotting that. So Gandhi lives on in those ways. We don't sing all Gandhian songs, nor do we write in the Gandhian way. But the essence of Gandhi, trust your people. Trust your authors. Don't impose your ideology, either right or left, on the writers, because otherwise things would be over. How can we go beyond Gandhi? My point is that unless you go beyond Gandhi, you can never be with Gandhi. Then you can be, then become a bandariya and you can have the dead child. You have to go beyond Gandhi in order to be with him. But in which way do you go beyond Gandhi? Not by forgetting him, but by remembering him, the only way we can remember him in our present times. Which is this only way we can remember him? There is a Gujarati poem on Rajghat, which remembers him so well. Hasmukh Pathak has written that. In Gujarati it says, Atla fulo niche ne atlo lambo samay Gandhi kadi suto nathi. For so long and under so many flowers, Gandhi has never slept. This must not be Gandhi. This must be somebody else. So if you remember his indomitable spirit working for the others, then you can go beyond the stereotype Gandhi. So Gandhi over the currency notes of our Indian currency has to be put aside. And Gandhi, who can lead us to our own Noakhalis, must be remembered. That's how we can go beyond Gandhi and create new Gujarati literature, new Indian literature. Thank you.
If we could just know a little more about, more specifically about how one could keep Gandhi alive in literature today, go beyond Gandhi in order to keep him with us. How specifically, you know, if you could tell us something more specific about how that could be done. Thank you.
A few things. Gandhi was open to the wide world. When he completed English translation of Hind Swaraj, he sent it to Leo Tolstoy. And there is correspondence between the two. He also read lots of world literature and he knew the world. Our world is different. We must have Gandhi's intelligence, courage, and self-confidence to reach out to the whole world today and write our own Hind Swaraj, because our own Hind Swaraj, if we have the capacity, would be very different. So that is one. Secondly, Gandhi never wrote a book either like Mao Zedong or Karl Marx. You must remember that. The way to go beyond Gandhi should not be the way to fall in the laps or at the feet of someone who wants to lead us. So that is most important. There are people in India and outside India who are most willing to lead us, to do our Jankalyan. So we must tell them, like Gandhi, that quit India, quit our personal lives, quit our collective lives. So that is second.
Yes, there was one question there. Volunteers, one question there. The lady in the green.
I am a Gujarati myself, so I'll ask him in a Gujarati. Tamne khas sambhadvaj aavya chhiye. He is a great name in our Gujarati literature. If you study Gujarati, then he is a great name in Gujarati literature. Sir, where do you find Gandhi now in India? Is Gandhi there, Gandhi ideology there in Gujarat or elsewhere? Kya hai tumne Gandhi dekha hai chhe?
We have a wonderful myth in our tradition. It pertains to the Vedas. It says that periodically there is a deluge and Vedas are submerged. And then Vedas once again are retrieved. I think this is a wonderful myth. If it appears to us that the Vedas are lost, one is mistaken. If it appears to us that Gandhi is dead or he is no more available. But what does it mean to be submerged? Which are the waters which drown you and do not strangle you? So Indian people's minds are basically like that. There are so many things that they are able to hide for a while. It appears that they are finished. I have a poem on this which I'll read. तू तो अब तो मैं गुजराती कविता से तो वाची संभाली थी। I have a feeling that we must let Gandhi sink deep down in us and for a while not talk about Gandhi. Because talking about Gandhi produces many difficulties. Because there are people like me who are so good at talking. And we do harm to Gandhi, people like me, and those who remain silent. In Gujarat, aaje itla bada loko che, Kach ma, Kathiyawad ma, Uttar Gujarat ma, nani nani jagaye, iti badi jagaye jene sevao kare che. Apna Ila Ben Bhatt, Dr. Ila Bhatt, who won Magsaysay Award for Seva. So these are the people who have submerged Gandhi. They never speak about Gandhi, but they do something. And finally, Gandhi was not born only because of his own will. He was not Swayambhu. He was a product of Indian culture. But product of a historicity of Indian culture. But there are other historicities which have taken over. And apnu kaam e che ke ye galat itihaso ko left wale bhi na kiya hai aur right wale bhi. So, ye galat itihason ko hame lagana. And that work could be done only by literature, because as I said in the morning, you know, there are some myths which are more historical than history, and there are some histories which are more mythical than myths.